हेलो एवरीवन, माय सेल्फ आर्किटेक्ट पूनम उपाध्याय फ्रॉम एपीजे स्कूल ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर एंड प्लानिंग, ग्रेटर नोएडा। आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू द ई लेक्चर सीरीज एज रिकमेंडेड बाय AKGU। सो टुडे मी एंड प्रोफेसर आनंद खत्री विल बी स्टार्टिंग विद द सब्जेक्ट टाउन प्लानिंग अंडर द सब्जेक्ट कोड RAR 804 एंड द टॉपिक इज कॉम्पैक्ट सिटी फॉर द वीक 15। Now coming on to the topic, that is compact city. We describe big city as crowded with very densely population. Cities were not always so crowded. It was around 300 years ago that the population size began to rise due to urbanization, which is basically a shift from rural to urban living. And the increased concentration of the human population in densely populated cities, and in fact around 1800 only 2% of the entire human population lived in cities. By 1950, the percentage of human population living in urban areas was up to around 29%, and by 2009 that number had reached up to 50%. This number is expected to the rapidly increasing by 2050, and it is predicted that 70% of the human population will live in urban areas. We think city as a productive and busy place. Many problems have arisen in cities due to the rapid population growth rates. And first problem is basically due to the lack of adequate housing, which has also given rise to the slum development in many cities. Then second problem is insufficient sewage system, which is basically another major problem in cities. Then third problem is increased abundance of cars. Now we know that there are certain problems with rapid growth of population. Now what are the ways to handle these problems? One way is that these issues are being addressed, which is known as compact development, and which is basically a development method that focuses on a building in a more compact way and that promotes a more livable urban community. Although we often think compact as crowded and maybe as a negative way, in this development methods, things are put closer together. Compact development basically focuses on pre-existing structure and preserving urban space by renovating pre-existing structures, by which housing can be more affordable. Compact development also incorporates more public transportation options, which can limit the reliance on car and decrease air pollution. And another benefit of compact development is to make city more livable, and it is the fact that communities are walkable. This is also good for the health of the residents' environment. This can also create stronger sense of community because people have got easier access to local resources. Now coming on to the core part of the lecture, this is the mind map for compact city. So exactly what we will be covering in today's lecture and what does the topic consist of? So mind map will tell you this. In compact city, I will be talking about origin of compactity, need of compactity, then elements of compactity, then benefits of compactity, which is further subdivided into three parts. First one is environmental benefits, second is social benefits, third is economic benefits. Then what are the positive and negative impacts of compactity? Then compactity in developed countries and compactity in developing countries, in which it consists of various heads like population growth, mixed use, goals and housing. And finally, the case study in which I have covered two international and one Indian case study. Apart from that, I will also be discussing about their issues, policies and finally their outcomes. Now I will be talking about origin of compactity. The term compactity first was given by George Danzig and Thomas L. Satie. They were basically two mathematicians whose utopian vision was to see more efficient use of resources. Concept of compactity is based on sustainability, a term which is used by the Club of Rome in 1972. So now, what is Club of Rome? So Club of Rome is basically was created to address the multiple crises facing humanity and the planet. It consists of politicians, business leaders, scientists, and these crises are basically population growth, decades of exponential consumption, etc. Then the compactities, they were created by the idea of sustainable urban planning in European cities in late 1990s. Now coming on to the what is compact city. It is a city of short distances in urban planning and urban design concept, which basically promotes relatively high residential density with mixed land use. It is also based on efficient public transport system, which encourages walking, cycling, reduced pollution and low energy consumption. It is also more sustainable urban settlement than urban sprawl. Now what is urban sprawl? Urban sprawl is basically another word for urbanization. It refers to the migration of a population from populated towns and cities to low density residential development over more and more rural land. The end result is spreading of the city. So I was saying compact city is more sustainable urban settlement type than urban sprawl because it is less dependent on car and require less provision of infrastructure. Apart from that, it also provide opportunities for social interaction to large population of residents as well as feeling of safety and eye on the street. So eye on the street, it means building must be oriented to the street, and when there is a crowd of people, our streets are safer to use. Because if suppose someone is in trouble, then eyes on a street are ready to assist and protect from danger. Now coming on to the various definition of compactity by various authors. First definition is by Elkin in 1991, who basically defined compactity as more intense use of space in the city with higher residential densities and centralization. Newman and Kenworthy in 1989 defined compactity as more intense land use, higher densities and centralized activities. Then Breheny in 1993 defined compactity as mixed use city, high density, where growth is basically encouraged within the boundaries of existing urban areas with no development beyond its periphery. Now coming on to the elements of compact city, if you see in right hand side figure, the first point is mixed land use and high density. So it is basically a mix of features, gives all residents easy access to services, roads and housing. Then second point is comprehensive service facilities. These include employment, legal and social services, gyms, playground, libraries, public toilets, grocery stores, restaurants and healthcare facilities. Then third point is short distance. So this basically encourage walking and cycling. Then fourth point is reduced pollution, means renewable energy sources reduce pollution. Then fifth point is car dependency. Cities where automobiles are the predominant transport not only limit residents' freedom of choice for mobility, but also create a culture of addiction to automobile use. Then sixth point is encouraging cycling. This refers to urban planning aspects that promote walking in urban areas. Then next is accessibility, which includes 100% barrier-free access and connected public spaces. Then comes efficient public transport, means comfort and punctuality make the public transport system more attractive. Then next is well-organized urban infrastructure. It means a well-planned city layout with a good public transportation system encourages walking and public transport use. Then finally, energy performance means local energy generation and heating using renewable resources. Now next is why we need compact city. So in the left hand side figure, it says due to the unplanned development. In the right hand side figure, it says due to increasing rate of private mode of transportation. In the third figure, which is below left hand side figure, it says due to greenhouse gas emission by private mode of transportation. Then in the fourth figure, which is below right hand side figure, it says due to reduction of per capita availability of land. So now the figure shows land in hectare and per capita availability of land in India, and it is very clear from the figure that the graph has got decreased from 0.89 to 0.2, which is basically from the year 1950 till 2015, which will. Now next comes what are the benefits of compact city. First is environmental benefit. We get less pollution from automobiles. Then in compact city, there is less energy consumption per capita. There is also a conservation of farmland and natural biodiversity. Then we have very fewer CO2 emission. In social benefit, first point is we get greater accessibility due to low cost. Then second point is we get lower transport cost, and third point is there is higher mobility for people without an access to car. Then fourth point is people get good health due to more cycling and walking. Fifth point is that quality of life is improved due to provision of more recreational activities. Then sixth point is when we get good quality of life due to access to local services such as shops and hospitals, etc. Then now coming on to the economic benefit. First point is Due to shorter travel time, there is higher productivity. Then second is there is a development of green technologies or jobs. Then third point is there is development of rural economic like renewable energy, urban agriculture, etc. Then fourth point is there is a less cost of maintenance and less infrastructure investments. Then due to innovation, creativity and more diversity, there is a greater productivity. Now next is compact city in developed and developing countries. First point is population growth in developed countries. The urban population ratio is 69.8% is to 84% and urban population is 1 billion. While in developing countries, urban population ratio is 26.7% is to 57.1%. And urban population is 2 billion. Now in developed countries, there is increase in amount of land area, decrease in population density. While in developing countries, there is increase in infrastructure supply so that to catch up with rapid population growth. In developed countries, there is increase in energy use, increase in average travel distance, increase of waste and pollution. And also there is increase in security status of urban infrastructure. While in developing countries, poverty is deteriorating urban environment and promoting equality in social, economic and political interference. Now next is goals in developed countries. There is advancement in quality of life. Then more consideration is given on basically placing a strong emphasis on mixed land use. While in developing countries, there is a less vacant land in urban areas because of the high population density. Then comes mixed use in developed countries. There is a very wise use of resources of conservation management of urban ecosystem, while in developing countries, there is not much visibility of wise use of resources, which is due to the immense population and it has a more pressure on resource utility. And in developed countries, there is a control of physical expansion and basically developing various guidelines for sustainable development of towns and cities. While in developing countries, undeveloped land that is of high valued because of urban agriculture, and if we lose this land, it would affect basically urban poor dweller. And next is housing in developed countries. Those who have low income and are urban poor, they tend to live in center, and the rich and middle class, they live on periphery of suburbs. While in developing countries, poorest people tend to live in center at very high density area, and on the periphery there is a cluster of poor people and they are low or medium density squatter settlements. So squatter settlements means they are the settlements which are unlawfully occupied. Now next is indicators of compact city. First I will be talking about general indicators and then goal specific indicators. First point in general indicator is regional GDP and second point is regional employment growth. Then third point is regional employment. Fourth point is about regional productivity by sectors. Then fifth point is built up areas. Then sixth point is density in built up areas. Then seventh point comes density of new residential development. Then eighth point comes sprawl. The ninth point is greenhouse gas emissions. Then 10th point is energy consumption. Then 11th point is share of public transportation use. Then next point is vehicle ownership. And the last point is length of public transportation lines per capita. Now coming on to the indicators which are goal specific. So the first point is residential energy use per capita. Then second point is area of a land for urban development. Then third point is concentration of urban facilities in the core areas. Then next point is diversity in land use in urban centers. Then next comes the green areas or the open areas. And finally, the levels of air pollution. Now I will be discussing about what is eco-compact city. So it is basically a city built and developed in balance with natural environment. It is a city which has a clear boundaries, which has a optimum ratio between density and network of open public spaces. It is also a city made with districts and organic urban neighborhoods, and it can also be metropolis. Eco-compact city provide eco-friendly environment, which basically encourages pedestrian movement and discourage the intensive use of automobiles. Its main goal is to create a very rich and interactive urban environment that basically optimizes the use of natural resources and reduces air pollution. Now, what are the positive impact of compact city? So, first goal is basically to shorten the community distance. In terms of environment, positive impact is less energy consumption, then less greenhouse gas emission, and in terms of economy, there is a less travel cost, less traffic congestion, which basically results in higher productivity and higher mobility. Then second goal is to maximize densification and intensification. Then third goal is to enhance quality of life and attractiveness in urban areas. Now in terms of environment, there is an efficient use of energy and lower electricity demand. And then there is a preservation of land for agriculture, water resources, etc. Then there is also an improvement at neighborhood level living environment, like green spaces, clean air, etc. In terms of economy, there is a provision of very cost-effective public service, and it also has maximized impact of public investment. There is also a frequent exchange of ideas which resulted increased innovation and knowledge, and also there is a higher quality of life. So now next is negative impact of compact city. So the first point is there is increase in crime level, and the second point is less domestic living space, and the third point is that there are higher death rate because of respiratory diseases, and the last point is that there is poor access to green areas and lack of affordable housing. So these are some of the points on negative impact of compact city. Now coming on to the case study of Hong Kong, China. Firstly, I will be talking about urban morphology of Hong Kong. So morphology basically means study of forms. So due to high rate of immigration from China and shortage of flat land in early 1980, it resulted in high densities of population and buildings in Hong Kong. Hong Kong is one of the most densely populated areas in the world, with an overall population density of 6,160 persons per square kilometer. Now you all can imagine how dense it is. There are many more densely populated districts, for example, Guangdong with 54,030 persons per square kilometer. It is basically a population density of this area. So if you see in the right hand side figure, this area is basically this particular space, and it is with the numeric number, if you can see from the figure, numeric number 11 is written over here. And the highest density is in the Mong Kok district with a population density of 1,16,000 residents per square kilometer. If you see in Hong Kong, urban development are constrained along the two sides of Victoria Harbour. So the first is Kowloon and the other side is Hong Kong Island. You can see this from the figure given above. In figure, Victoria Harbour is there and the development is constrained along Kowloon and Hong Kong Island. So Victoria Harbour is basically this particular space and Kowloon is basically this particular area. And the other side of Kowloon is Hong Kong Island. So if you see in figure, due to angular coastline, the developments are highly concentrated at the top of Kowloon Peninsula and they are used for commercial purposes. So angular coastline is basically this coastline I am talking about, and the developments, they are concentrated at the top of Kowloon Peninsula, which is this particular area, and they are used for the commercial purposes. And another strip of dense development is situated along the northern shore of Hong Kong Island, which is basically this northern shore, and which has an area of about 22.5 square kilometer, which is 17 kilometer long and 1.3 kilometer wide. Apart from planning, you also need to understand land use of a city. Now this is a land use map to just give an idea that where are residential areas, where are commercial areas, where are open spaces, where are grasslands, woodlands, shrublands, etc. So you need to have an idea about the land use map of a city. Now to get more land for development near the existing developed areas, large scale reclamation is taking place and it will produce about 32% more new land, which will complement the existing 1053 hectares of reclaimed land along the harbour. In old areas, if you see, old block renewal on large scale is the only option to increase space. With low to medium rise developments got converted into high density rise developments. Therefore, reclamation and urban renewal, they are two of the planning strategies that government is implementing in urban development. Now, what are the reclamation based urban development strategy? Reclamation was designated along Victoria Harbour, as I already told you, and it was, I can say, economic gateway to the outside world. So by 1924, a total of 500 hectares of land had been reclaimed. In the period from 1950 to 1970, the government shifted the focus towards urban decentralization by the development of new towns. Due to immigrants and transfer of industrialization from southern China in 1950s, there was a great demand for land and housing. So if you see on the right hand side figure, so the numeric space 8, that is Suin 1, and the numeric space 9, which is Tuin Mun, then the numeric space 5, which is basically this particular area, which is Sha Tin, and the numeric space 7, Suin Quan, which is this area. These are basically the reclaimed land. from 1980 onwards, reclamation has concentrated on the shores of harbor. Now next is new town development, decentralization. TDD, the Territorial Development Department in 1973. It was set up basically to implement the new town program. At that time, the main objective was to provide land for developing public housing in new territories. So the basic concept of new town development was to create self-contained communities and balanced. And this is done by providing basic needs, community facilities and infrastructure. The first new towns were having a housing of 1.8 million people, to date about 3 million, and more than 40% of the total population of Hong Kong live in new towns and having a target of accommodating 4 million people. Now coming on to the urban renewal favoring urban intensification. Government carried out pilot redevelopment scheme in early 1960s, whose objective was to redevelop the old buildings and improving the congested condition of old residential areas. So as shown in the right hand side figure, Shween Wan, which is basically this particular area, it was chosen an urban renewal district in 1965. But this scheme took one decade to get completed. In the past decade, Land Development Corporation, that is LDC, has taken action on 52 urban renewal projects, out of which only 15 were completed, and residential redevelopment was the main components of these 52 projects. Now the figure above shows land use mix of 52 redevelopment projects in Hong Kong in 1998 with their zone wise areas and percentage of total area. Basically, urban renewal is heavily dependent on the private sector. Old buildings have been redeveloped and demolished into high rise and high density buildings. For example, is the center. As you can see from the right hand side figure, it is basically a 80 story skyscraper which got completed in 1998. It has 8816 square meter site area. It contained 1,202,126 square meter gross floor area for high quality office space, and it has 4,798 square meter for commercial space. Apart from that, it has 3,108 square meter for government, community facilities and institutional, and 927 square meter for open space. Therefore, urban renewal intensifies development by increasing the plot ratio through high-rise built form, and thus it achieve an efficient land use. This is an image of Shween Wan before redevelopment is shown in left hand side figure, and after redevelopment is shown in right hand side figure. Next is sustainable transport system. Hong Kong transport system is operated by public and private operators, Mass Transit Railway and Kowloon Canton Railway. They both are operated by public bodies. The other transport carriers, they are operated by private operators, and this all has resulted in a efficient and cost effective transport system. Now next is shifting the energy base in transport sector. Reduction in negative environment impact has given major direction to future planning of Hong Kong. Shift from diesel to LPG produce fewer pollutants, and it is one of the means to reduce harmful emissions. In present, Hong Kong rely upon diesel mode, in which 53% are buses and 12% are taxis. Then there was third comprehensive transport study, which was done in September 1999, which basically evaluated that the environmental benefits and cost of various transport development options. So the option included compulsory use of LPG for all new taxis which are registered from 2001, and possibilities of using alternative fueled vehicle such as electric trolley buses. Now next is higher priorities given to rail transport. Government has given significant role to heavy rail system among all different transport modes, and this is due to low marginal cost, higher capacity and less polluting service. Heavy rail provide fast, reliable services to commuters, and they are basically friendly to environment. They also reduce pressure on the roads. And the last is pedestrianization. It reduces the number of short motorized trip and pollutant emissions. However, very few used to travel on foot because of unfriendly walking environment and the busy roads. Consideration is given to great separate walkways so as to encourage walking for short distance trips and provide direct access to the building and transport interchanges. So the issues identified are increasing rate of pollution and segregation of various activities. Policies that were introduced to solve these issues are concept of compactness and concept of verticality. And finally, the outcomes are development along transit corridor, urban compact form reduced the 1/4 of the travel time. They achieved maximum density of 9,600 inhabitants per and 2,048 households per square kilometer. Then high-rise development, 30 to 60 stories. I have given you the example of center skyscraper. Another case study is Amsterdam, Netherlands compact city. So it was originally designed for defense, and if you see on right hand side figure, it is basically composed of circles that create tiny islands which are then linked by bridges. And if you see in figure, city center is very compact. Apart from that, city has narrow streets and create a walkable and interesting environment. Now next is land expansion of Amsterdam. So figure shows expansion throughout the ages. Like if you see from the figure, expansion is in the form of circles, and it is the expansion that has taken in 13th century, in 17th century, in 19th century, at the beginning of 20th century, and even after the Second World War. Next is transportation system in Amsterdam. Trains connection to the Dutch of Europe from Amsterdam was a very well thought concept. Tram within a city provide fast and cheap transportation, but daily movement is by bicycle through compact city. Bike is a good solution to tiny street system and a perfect way to enjoy urban landscape. Amsterdam is said to be cycling capital of world. That's why it has been said sustainability is in Amsterdam genes. Today it is one of the 10th most sustainable cities on earth, and in Europe one of the top 4. Apart from that, city has sustainable living, sustainable mobility, sustainable economic, sustainable energy. When I say sustainable energy,
So at present it has 5.8% of energy consumed in Amsterdam, which is derived from sustainable sources, and all the cities, metro, train and tram run on it. Next is sustainable mobility. It is the most bicycle friendly city in the world. It has 400 km dedicated cycle path, and 90% of road network is safe and suitable for cycling. Electric transport, which has network of on-street parking at which the owners of electric car and scooters can park and top up their batteries free of charge. Now next is sustainable economic. Amsterdam already plays sustainable business activities like finance, tourism, trade, etc. For rapid growth of companies, sustainability is the main force which is basically fueling their innovation. A trail so-called smart air curtains. So the smart air curtains, they are basically air door, a fan powered devices which are used for separating two spaces from each other. So I was saying a trail so called smart air curtain and automatic shop door achieved 43% saving on energy cost and reduced level of noise and exhaust fumes inside the store without affecting the customer. So next is sustainable living. Amsterdam residents are generally satisfied with their living environment. People in Amsterdam have developed positive attitude towards other ethnic communities over the past 2 years. Amsterdam has 200 primary school and 28 special school, which has reduced about 30 to 40% carbon dioxide and permanent reduction in energy cost, and the schools are of better quality. Then the last is neighborhood parks. After the Second World War, there is an amazing number of neighborhood playgrounds which were designed and built in the city. As you can see from the right hand side figure, how the number got increased in 1961 as compared to the neighborhood parks in 1954. So these yellow ones are the neighborhood playgrounds in 1961. And you can compare the numbers in 1954. So it has been drastically increased in 1961. So if we compare these two figures, in 2016 figure, we can clearly see that green areas are basically new green space since 2003, and red areas are basically lost green space since 2003. Now what are the issues that I identified? They are basically growth along various direction. If you see the plan in previous slides, growth is in all direction. Policies that have been made to solve the issues are: first policy is to optimize land use by intermingling functions and densification. Then second policy is to create a continued clustering and concentrate urbanization. Then third policy is in the vicinity of multimodal public hubs concentrating regional amenities and public services. Then fourth policy is to create a space for socio-cultural mix and functionally mixed. Now what are the outcomes? By urban intensification, clustered development is created, creation of multifunctional development, and lastly, provision of accessibility to public transportation by inducing the development along transit corridors. The last case study is high density development Ahmedabad. If you see in the figure, it shows growth of Ahmedabad from 1411 to 2012 and how the city started its development along the river course and how it got spreaded on both the sides of the river in 2012. So I will be directly coming on to the point in this particular case study. I will be talking about bus rapid transit system, which is basically Genmark bus rapid transit system, which got introduced in 2009. The phase 1 is basically of 45 kilometers and the phase 2 is basically of 58 kilometers and the phase 3 is of 40.2 kilometers. So if you see from the right hand side figure, so the dark orange line, which are basically these lines, they are BRTS first phase. And if you see the light green lines, these lines are basically BRTS second phase. And the lighter orange line, if you see, so these are basically BRTS third phase. So the daily ridership increased from 13,000 in 2000. Ahmedabad has compact structure due to land use transformation. After the execution of BRTS structure, the Ahmedabad Urban Development Authority decided to intensify in and around the nodes. So the minimum plot size is 1500 meter to 2500 meter and the 100 meter roads are zoned as high intensity development zone with FSI 4, as you can see from the figure which is given below. And up to 250 meter is also an intensification zone with FSI 3 and rest of the city is to get 2.75 FSI. To encourage high density developments by giving more FSI, densification along the transit corridor are done successfully. They have achieved the maximum density of 190 persons per hectare through the process of densification along the BRTS corridor. Now the issues that I have identified, so the first issue is there is more traffic congestion, then the second issue is increasing rate of private mode of transportation. Then the third issue is lack of availability of land. Then the fourth issue is creating employment opportunities. Then what are the policies to overcome these issues? The first policy is to optimize land use by densification and intermingling functions. Then second is to create a continued clustering and concentrate urbanization. Then third is development along the transit corridor. And lastly, high density development by the way of giving more FSI in the transit corridor. Now, what are the outcomes? Accessibility to public transportation by inducing development along transit corridors, then multifunctional development, then finally high density development like up to 190 persons per hectare. Now, coming on to the applicability to India's context. There is a vast growth of existing metropolitan cities like Bangalore, Chennai, Mumbai, etc., which has resulted scattered developments. There is also lack of matching infrastructure, large share of slums in cities, traffic congestion and lack of land availability, degraded natural environment in cities and pollution. So, compact urban development is the best solution to meet growing housing demand. Now, I would like to request Professor Anand Khatri to continue this lecture by giving his some more thoughts in this lecture. Thank you all for your precious time.
After this wonderful discussion on compact city, we must now move on to see how in history compact city existed. And we must also try to see what the international discussion on compact city is and what the CNU, the Charter for New Urbanism, is trying to indicate in with reference to the subject. A very interesting example of compact city exists in a Neolithic settlement called Catalhoyuk, and this is in Anatolia in Turkey, and it has got houses which have access through the roof. In Catalhoyuk, you can see the existence of a community and living spaces with one large region, and all the houses are actually cubicles which are accessible from the roof. You climb down inside a house. The plan that you see of Catalhoyuk here is very similar to any of the plans in urban areas today. The placement of the houses in such a dense manner is suggestive of a very organic development. And when we look at the way the city functions as a compact city, we realize that almost 40% to 50% of the open spaces that we embed in between the houses through roads and parks and open public squares have all been eliminated, and there is a continuous connectivity in between houses through the roof. There has to be a reason, more than just a climatic reason, for a society to be existing in a way as compact as this. If I try to reason it out beyond what appears on the plan, then it is one, pedestrianization. Then it is the lack of wheeled transport, or the use of wheel for transporting, as in cars or cycles or bullock carts. And more than everything else, there is a segregation of the house and the landscape. The house does not read in line with the landscape. There's a very clear-cut indication of aesthetic appreciation of geography, wherein the houses are clubbed and confined to certain areas which are living areas, as in the case of a termite hill or a burrowing animal, and then the rest of the space is left open. So this is not definitely in that time in line with a green or maybe an environmental consideration towards a settlement or a city, but it is something beyond that. The gradual densification to which all our settlements reach in the heart of city centers, as in the case of Shahjahanabad or as in the case of any of the urban villages that you see around in Delhi and Noida, all this densification is indicative of a resultant compaction of areas. Whatever be the reason is unspecified. It's not commerce, it's not the use of spaces, it's beyond that. It is a tendency of humans to grow close to each other, to live close to each other, and to share spaces. So when communities grow old, when you and your friends grow old friends, then you can live within the same space, you can coexist, you can share your environment. It is more about community aspiration, it is more about shared living. There are many such examples which follow the same synergic thought of compaction, wherein complex structures lie in conjunction with houses, and the movement in between each of them is either through the roofs or through broad walls, which are above at an elevated level. When we look at the example of the Pueblos, the most continuously existing form of human settlement and also recognized by the UNICEF as an important example, the Taos Pueblo, which is still existing, shows a living wherein the terraces are joined. On the extreme right hand side, on the drawings that are there, we see a complete community living together, which is actually climbing down into rooms and coming out of rooms and living on terraces, or climbing terraces to reach up another level. Now, there are many climatic interpretations to it also, and many contextual interpretations. But beyond the context of climate and geography is a society. It's a social pattern. It's a social proximity which our cities are missing. We are living in nuclear units. We feel that we are isolated, that we can actually step away from everything that is around us into confined boundaries. What I really am amazed at in the planning of cities and houses in our country is the use of a boundary. Everything is having a boundary. Nothing is continuous. The minute you buy a plot, the first thing that you do is make a boundary. It is not just a indicator of a limit, but it is also an indicator of a definition. A definition which is existing within a bigger definition. So the whole context of this is anti-compact. The whole context that gets established in these kind of a boundary or these kind of outlined lives, these kind of isolated societies, is that we are different, that we need everything separate from the society for us. So if there's a tap in my house to water plants outside my house, there's a tap in the adjoining house also to water plants outside the house. So it's not just about the house. So then it becomes the house, or then it becomes a building, or then it becomes a campus to the city. So each campus has a repetitive definition, a repetitive use, a repetitive installation for the same function which could have been incorporated as a public function. So we need to relook as to how we are living as a society also while we are heading with this discussion on compact city. The Lobi houses in Ghana are also indicative of a similar living pattern wherein the house was a fortification and people used to climb out of the house. We had a very brief look at how the historic settlements of Catalhayuk and Taos Pueblo indicated compact living. When you look at Shahjahanabad, or when you look at any of the dense urban villages in Noida or in Greater Noida, you would look at a situation wherein people are living in a similar proximity. The plan of Catalhayuk, which was there in the earlier slides, and the plan of any urban or organic area in India is similar. It is similar geometry, it is similar in definition, it is similar in terms of the placement of plots, the relationship of one plot to the other. The cellular plan, which forms a close synergy to how the epidermis in the body is, to how other cellular structures exist, indicates a pattern. Now, not going into that pattern, and after this discussion on history, if we look at what the Charter for New Urbanism, the latest outline of how our cities should be, the CNU talks about a city or an urban area in 1996, then we see very clear hints of compaction, very clear hints of pedestrianization, humanization, very clear hints of having a city which is not the kind of a city that we all are living in. Now, a charter is an outline written for defining an institution, a city, a program, a grant, or an agreement. So the Charter for New Urbanism is an indicator of how we should look at our urban areas as per the new thought of CNU. It talks about the spread of placeless sprawl, and it hints at this as a very important deterrent. Then it also talks about environmental deterioration. It is already explained that our cities need to be compact for the reason of our agriculture, our open lands, our forests, as much for the social benefit, as much for the optimization of area under development, as much for social benefit, sharing of facilities, and a more secure life. Now, in the charter, I've highlighted a few points which I will be reading out, and I will be trying to highlight how the CNU is advocating a compactness, how it is advocating reuse, how it is advocating building economics, space economics, cultural synergies, and it is addressing all the issues that are present in our today's development. It talks about restoration of existing urban centers and towns within coherent metropolitan regions. Then it says that the reconfiguration of sprawling suburbs into communities of real neighborhoods and diverse districts, the conservation of natural environments, and the preservation of our built legacy. The clear hint here is that we must check the way we have been expanding. While reading these points, we must try and go into the soul of the intent and not just read words. So in the next point, it talks about pedestrians and transit as well as the car. That is, an urban area should be designed for both. And then it says that cities and towns should be shaped by physically defined and universally accessible public spaces and community institutions. It says that physical solutions by themselves will not solve social and economic problems. But neither can economic vitality, community stability, and environmental health be sustained without a coherent and supportive physical framework. Yani ki, sirf architecture agar solution nahi hai, to sirf social or economic solutions hi solution nahi hai. We will have to join hands. Haath milane padenge. Haath mila karke kaam karna padega. The CNU charter goes on to say to re-establishing the relationship between the art of building and the making of community through citizen-based participatory planning and design. This is such an important point. Now we move on to the next, where the CNU is talking about finite places and not infinitely spreading areas. Then it says that the relationship is environmental, economic, and cultural. Farmland and nature are as important to the metropolis as the garden is to the house. It also says that the development patterns should not blur or eradicate the edges of the metropolis. It is talking about stark edges. It is talking about more definitions. It is talking about limiting. It is talking about compaction. This becomes more clear as we move on to the other areas of the charter, where it says that transit, pedestrian, and bicycle systems should maximize access and mobility through the region while reducing dependence upon the automobile. And it says that neighborhoods should be compact, pedestrian friendly, and mixed use. When we go to more mature communities, we find compaction only because a space share is possible, only because people can live next to each other in close proximity and share facilities. It says that neighborhoods should be compact, pedestrian friendly, and mixed use. Districts generally emphasize a single use and should follow the principles of neighborhood design when possible. It talks about corridors and regional connectors, but then it says that many activities of daily living should occur within walking distance, allowing independence to those who do not drive, especially the elderly and the young. If you look at the way the cities are today, they are settlements with wide roads running in between them, the width of the road almost half of the depth of the house, or at times as much as the depth of the house. That is, one half of the house area is actually on the road, or even more in case of highways or in case of areas which have got expressways and wide bridges running through. Now, what does that indicate? It indicates development only for a very specific section of the society, a section which is using the car. It is not about an economic strata. It is about what section of the society uses cars. It is only from the age group of, say, 20 or 25 or 30 to 50 years maybe people are using cars. Beyond that, the use of car diminishes. The aspiration for a car or an automobile diminishes. The economic patterns change. Children don't drive cars. The elderly don't drive cars. They need places to walk. They need places to play. They need pedestrian interconnectivity. They need proximity. Now, while we are talking about walking distances, there also has to be this issue on proximity. How will that proximity happen of a use area from the house? It will only happen through compaction. So while greening and biophilic has been the argument in our previous discussions, compaction and increasing densities is also an important argument. It is also a very important aspect of the solution. Now, these points on this slide, the last slide, are very interesting. It talks about appropriate building densities and land uses within walking distance of transit stops, permitting public transport to become a viable alternative to the automobile. It also talks about concentration of civic, institutional, and commercial activity, which should be embedded in neighborhood and social districts, not isolated in remote, single-use complexes. It is talking about a very different level of mixing of land uses. It is anti to the thought where we confine our buildings within boundaries, isolated single-use complexes. It is talking about a compaction, elimination of unnecessary. Then it says that individual architectural projects should be seamlessly linked to their surroundings. It is talking about building unity, construction unity. Then it says that in the contemporary metropolis, development must adequately accommodate automobiles. It should do so in ways that respect the pedestrian and form of public space. Streets and squares should be safe, comfortable, and interesting to the pedestrian. So while we are looking at the CNU, and while we look at the historic settlements, and while we had discussions on many of the recent urban examples of cities in the earlier discussions, and we also ran this discussion through Shahjahanabad and horse cars and Bhangel and all these areas which are around us, we realize that there is a possibility of a great change in case if we bring our cities closer and hold them tight so that there is enough space for the environment, so that the sharing of facilities is happening, so that economies of construction are there, so that we don't damage the environment through our quarries, through our construction activities, through our large carbon footprint. And we make this concept of urban, which is a very recent concept and which has never had a continuity like the forest has had in all these centuries. And we must make it sustainable. Thank you.